So today I think we'll go with the new topic, and that is the Harrod-Domer model. So you already have gone through this Harrod-Domer model in your fourth semester. Okay, so we'll see the basics of Harrod-Domer model first of all. Okay. See, in the world economy, whenever there was a growth model from this Harrod-Domer model, after that there was a recapitulate also by the Paul Samuelson, which says that no new light has been thrown on the reasons why poor countries are poor and the rich countries are rich. See here the growth analysis, which we are trying to explain with this Harrod-Domer model, that is actually giving a reason. There is some difference that why the poor countries are poor and the rich countries are rich. But basically, all classical theories and the neoclassical theories, especially neoclassical theories, they are talking about initial capital. So those who are having the higher initial capital, they are the richer countries, and those who are not having this initial capital much, they would be considered as a poor countries. A range of forces can explain why some countries are rich and the other poor. Economic endowments are important. The institutions which they were talked about, so it comprises of how would you generate this initial income. So it's based on the institutions. These all are affecting, like I'm talking about the different school of thoughts in the economy, which is giving you an idea, and also based on the endowments, that is the initial capital. So dialectic model is a useful way of looking at the development process. So what's that model? That is the capitulate. How can poor economies catch up to take off into sustained growth? As I was mentioning that the solo has talked about this, how the poor countries would converge to all developed countries, the earliest also, even at the faster growth also, because they might have lower diminishing returns. But this analysis of Harrod-Domer is not talking about that, this diminishing returns, though there could be the junking ratio, there could be the productive capacity, but may also can get depreciation through the production process. So modern economic growth only occurred after the Industrial Revolution. For many LDCs, growth began only in the post-World War II, and today, gap between rich and poor countries exist in income per head, and this gap countries through continues to grow. Okay, so because of this rich and poor gap, and that could be the initial capital, and because of that, the countries are showing a different pace of or a different pattern of growth. Like if you talk about a richer countries, they may, at the initial stage, they may earn more increasing returns, and then later on more diminishing returns. But this probably will not happen in case of poor countries. They may have less capital, but they may utilize their more labor with the less diminishing returns. Then theories of how economies catch up are embodied in theories of economic growth. So that's important, and which is basically analyzed by all these theories of neoclassical with the unconditional convergence. Understand what combination of circumstances drive economic growth. We need to see that. And when is an economy capable of steady state growth at a constant rate? So this says that the all neoclassical and the classical, they are actually talking about a steady state growth at a constant rate. As I was mentioning in the previous fundamentals too, that the economic growth would not be resulting in steady state in case of endogenous growth model. So most all the exogenous models, you would find that steady state growth level. So here also they are looking for a steady state growth with the Harrod-Domer model, with the solo model, and with other models too of exogenous theories. How did the Harrod-Domer model attempt to answer this question? So the model of Harrod and Domo formed the basis of Soviet plan development and the development planning in India. Okay, so that is entirely based on, you know, those countries who are actually making the plannings for the projection for the 5 years or the 10 years for the future development. Okay, because those countries are the poor countries or maybe your least developed or the developing countries. So why? Because they have started their analysis only for those countries who are the least developed one or the developing one. Though their analysis was more overemphasized on the capital part, so it went for the all developed nation. But later on, within some extension and some amendments, they have come up and they've given their model for the developing countries too. But for now, we'll just go through the basics of it, what Harrod's assumption, what Domo's assumption, and what they talked about it. Then we assume a closed economy in this. At any date T or a time period T, national income is divided between consumption and saving. So as I was mentioning earlier also, that the saving and capital, these are the two important part for them. And from this saving itself, they would go for more investment. Now, why there is a need of this consumption bias, very important, as I was mentioning earlier also, that the consumption, if you'll do today more, then the saving would be less. Okay. If saving would be less, then the your steady state growth path would be more longer to you. Okay. So consumption, if you control today, fine, or with the less population, or by utilizing more capital with the, you know, per labor, if you're making this, so your consumption may be controlled today, or you're not consuming much and you're saving more, it means you're sacrificing something today to make happy your future and the future generation. Okay, so that is the idea of all these theories, and that's why we do follow the Keynesian concept and also the income fundamentals, which is the sum of consumption, which is in the T time period, and plus saving in the T time period. So the value of output produced by must also be equal to the consumption, goods produced, and the goods needed by investors. Fine. So these two things are also important to arrive at the steady state growth. As we were mentioning here, the steady state growth is common for exogenous models, and this Harrod and Domo model is defining their steady state growth by taking these two parameters, which is the consumption and then saving. And then you can maximize your real GDP, which is the target of exogenous model. So saving must be equal to investment. That assumption they're taking, you know, as it is from the Keynesian model. So ST and this T time period saving, and that has to be equal to the investment. So whatever you will save today, okay, this saving has to be converted into the investment. And if it is happening, then only your capital productivity would be higher. So this way only your productivity curve would go, you know, further, and also in the long run can have a jump also or shift also. Denote the national capital stock by K. This K is here, basically they're considering K0 would be an initial capital. And then further, they are defining K T plus 1. It means in a T time period, what capital stock you have, there would be an increment in the future. And every time, whenever you are utilizing this capital, you must have some depreciation along with that. Okay. So directly, of course, they're not talking about diminishing returns to scale, but this is associated with this, this capital stock utilization. Though in their assumptions, even in Solow's assumption also, they are following constant returns to scale. But this comes whenever you are utilizing your capital, the diminishing returns would be there, and these diminishing returns would affect your pace of growth. It means how you fast converge to the nations for the steady state growth. That is entirely depends on how you utilize your capital based on your initial capital. So this is also very important, which is your initial capital, and then further how you do investment. So further, they are connecting it with the savings, because the country like India, they have a more population. If the people are not able to save more, they will not able to invest more. So if more investment will not be there, then this component would now be lower. And if it is lower, then of course, if you do not have more capital, this depreciation rate will also be lesser. But the growth may also be faster. But that is the analysis of Solo. But still, this initial capital is also the emphasis of Harrod and Normer model. So capital stock changes over time, and that is why because the investment is equals to saving.